Hello, YouTube. The Blob here, and welcome to episode 7 of Where Night Goblins Dare, 2015 Historicon ETC Tournament Battle Number 2, or... I can't believe it. Same ogre time, same ogre channel. Wah, wah. So, it's basically game 2 of the tournament. I won the first game, and I didn't even change tables. Stayed at the same table, and another ogre player showed up. This was one of the fellas from my group. Actually, the son of a guy from our group, but the son is also in our group. And here we go with ogres again. So, believe it or not, not only was I on the same table, but I ended up on the same table side. So I basically deployed my army in almost the exact same way and tried to use the exact same tactics. I want to go after his chaff so that mine can run free and, you know, just do what I do. This episode takes place at the Fredericksburg Expo Center because reasons. I'm not going to go through my army list. You can go to episode 6, because episodes 6, 7, and 8 will all be the same Orc and Goblin army list I'm using, because they're all in the tournament. But let me run through this Ogre players list, because it's a little bit different from the Ogre army I ran into in episode 6. There's a Tyrant, Heavy Armor, no Shield. Tyrant, Heavy Armor, Fencer Blades. That's why no shield. Talisman of Preservation and the Potion of Strength. Slaughtermaster level 3 with a great weapon, the Armor of Destiny and Dispel Scroll. There's a Bruiser who's a BSB with a great weapon, heavy armor, Opal Amulet, and the Crown of Command. I'm not really sure what the Opal Amulet does. A Butcher level 2, so he's got 5 levels of magic here. Butcher level 2, and this guy's just rocking the Hell Heart. Basically every ogre list in 8th edition Warhammer Fantasy Battle uses the Hell Heart, people. A block of 6 ogres with full command. A block of 8 iron guts with full command and a banner of swiftness. So these are not great weapon iron guts, just regular iron guts. Unless all iron guts are great weapon, you know. 4 man-eaters with the scout skill and the standard discipline, and you'll see during this game that perhaps I treat them with a little more respect than they deserve. 4 lead belchers, 2 saber tusks, an iron blaster, and a bull gorger. So, here's deployment, and like I said, I pretty much deployed the way I did before. From left to right, I got a little goblin shaman, a disposable heroes bow unit of 20 night goblins with bow, pump wagon, bus of goblins there, Wurzag touching the giant brick 8 trolls, Doomdiver, another bus of goblins, Mango Squig in front there, Urg, touching that bus of goblins, and then another disposable bow unit right there. Ignore the banner in it. Rock Lava, Mango Squig, Doomdiver, Wolves, and last Rock Lava. Looking at my opponent's deployment from his right to his left, we got those scouting man-eaters right there in that tree line, all by themselves. Saber Tusk near the blue and black dice, along with the lead belcher. Iron Guts, Ogres, Characters. Another Saber Tusk, right where the hedge line is there. Barely visible. And 4 Iron Blasters. or whatever the hell they are. So, Ogre's got the turn to go first, and he just sort of moves up. You can see there, he's got Iron Guts and the Bulls coming right at me. And Lead Belchers, whatever they are, kind of moving up. He's definitely moving forward, but it's probably not his maximum move. He doesn't want to just sit in front of the Mangler Squigs, so good move there. In shooting, he annihilates a Pump Wagon, which panics that bow unit, which runs off the table. They're not off the table in this shot, but they will be. They're not going to rally. We don't need spoilers for that. We know what leadership for Night Goblins are. When there's no one around to tell them not to do shit like that. Yeah. And then also some Wolf Riders get blasted. And I think these are the Lead Belchers that did this from over by the house. But the Wolves don't panic. 2 go down out of 5, but they don't panic. So not bad there. Orc and Goblin turn 1. And I'm definitely going to go after his chaff, but I'm not sure what to do about this double block in front of me. It's actually off to my right flank a little bit, but the double block and then the Man-Eaters. I keep looking at the Man-Eaters. I keep saying to myself, 4 Ogres, I mean, it can't be that dangerous, but they do have the Banner Swiftness so they can get at me quick, and I don't want to send something I love over there to kick their butt, and now with that bow unit running off the table, you know, I mean, I can't really hold them up or anything. So I throw the Manglers forward like this, and just sort of shuffle about, but barely move, basically. On the right, Wolf Riders. Wolf Riders go into the Saber Tusk at the hedge. I don't know. Maybe I can do something to that thing, but the point is I want to keep it away from the Mangler Squigs. I don't want him just throwing the Saber Tusk on the Mangler Squigs. And then the other unit, Wolf Riders, moves up to the house like this. I can tell you what I was thinking at the time was the Ogres won't be able to just shoot them, you know. That was what I was thinking at the time. And you'll see that was just stupid. In magic and shooting, Tiny Little Shaman plus Wurzag with his Vindictive Glare spell equals no more Saber Tusk up near the well. And my Wolf Riders got rid of the other one. And Doom Diver Rock Lava combo might have killed an ogre or two. I mainly targeted the big blocks with the lavas, but one of the lavas definitely misfired. No question of that. I mean, when I look at the situation, I've got the Manglers holding him up. He can't chaff him anymore. So, I mean, I feel pretty good. I mean, I'm not feeling amazing, but I feel like, you know, he's not charging on his turn 2 no matter what. Ogre turn 2, and the only charge I really remember is the Man-Eaters with Swift Stride, or whatever it is, the Banner of Swiftness. They come out of the woods, they charge the little Goblin Shaman, who's up on the hill there. You can see he's turned to face the camera, because he ran for his life. He's not putting up with that. And if he had stood and they made contact, they'd overrun into something and pin me down. So yeah, no, he runs, they fail their charge. Other than that, it's possible that the regular bull unit with the light blue banner failed the charge, but you can see they moved way up near the hedge. They triggered fanatics from the disposable bow unit on my right. And you can see that the Iron Guts are just sort of sitting in front of the Mangler Squigs, not really interested in moving through those at the moment. On his left, my right, you can see the Lead Belchers just turn around the house, and that's when I sit there and I think to myself, what the hell was I doing? Because now he's just going to blast those Wolves smooth off the table right there. Just disgusting. And Bull Gorger shows up. I don't know if I forgot he had this guy or what. It would be like me to forget that somebody has a unit like this, but boom, puts it right there. Now obviously it's not charging the Doom Diver. He's just facing it in anticipation of charging the Doom Diver. And after that, I start to think, probably going to lose this game. But I'm going to put everything I got into the Bull Gorger, that's for sure. After the Bull Gorger shows up, things kind of get nuts. Turns are missed. Photographs aren't taken. People are upset. Not really. Nobody's upset. No, we've been having a pretty good time with this game. But the point is, basically, Mangler Squigs run off and do their thing. Wolf Rider's just wildly running around the table. You can see in this shot, excuse me, you can see in this shot with the light blue banner and the regular bulls in the goblin bus with my BSB and Urk, the disposable bow unit is gone. Alright? So basically what happened was, is I believe the ogres charged the disposable bow unit, crushed it, turned to face. And then I charged them. Now, I don't know if this was a good idea or not. You can, you know, leave a comment if you want at the video. But basically, I saw no choice. I didn't angle the trolls very well. And I was still concerned about the man-eaters for some stupid-ass reason. But you can see the trolls aren't in a position to counter-charge. So I think I put Urg and the BSB and everybody right into that bull unit to take away their overcharge. And start chopping away at their general, because their general's in this unit in the whole nine. I didn't really feel good about it at the time, I'm not kidding. I would have preferred to send like a single character to chaff him up, or take Urg and the BSB out of the bus unit and then shove it in, treat it like a thing of zombies, and let the bull unit chew its way through eventually while the trolls did something, but I'm pretty sure I charged here. Maybe my opponent can remind me at some point. And you can see in this next shot, combat ensues. Sadness begins to affect me as goblins are hewn out of the ranks, and you can see a red die next to Urg Pig Destroyer, almost dead center. And he's got two wounds. So basically, my opponent's general was a powerhouse of a man. Not your standard soft general from other races. No, this guy was 10 tons of monster. Kind of like the guy from Indiana Jones, the secret German aircraft, the propeller, the whole thing. Yeah, anyway, Urg badly wounded, goblin hero in the first rank also wounded. That's what that green die is. Squigs running amok. Lead belchers shooting at him, wolves in the background doing nothing. Now, here's another shot, and what you can see is I've tried to reposition the trolls, but, and there's a troll missing from a cannonball, and Wurzag is back behind the trolls now instead of attached to the unit. What you can see here is, I don't know what I'm doing at this point. It's game two, I'm having fun, but I'm not thinking. Trolls should have just lashed out at the man-eaters and called it a day, I guess. I don't know. And then, during my magic phase, I'm able to hand a Gork, the other bus unit of goblins, up and over the trolls into the face of the Iron Cuffs. Because I couldn't charge the trolls into the flank of the bulls and free up Urg and his homies. I just couldn't do it. The arc wasn't there, totally blew it. So I literally just handed Gork this giant bus of goblins up front to absorb the charge of the Iron Guts. And I threw the little shaman up into the face of the man-eaters. And Bull Gorger, by the way, sorry, I almost forgot this, Bull Gorger just blasted by Doomed Ivor Fire. I wasn't able to shoot anything else, but yeah, Bull Gorger. Annihilated by Doomed Ivor Fire and taken off the board as easily as he was put on. The fight goes on with Urg and the bus and the other and the ogres with the light blue banner, but yeah, in this second to last shot, man eaters into the little shaman. You know, he's dead meat, but at least they're facing away. Iron Guts into the bus of goblins. I hand a Gork into the path of destruction. And towards the bottom right, you can see the bus fighting, the goblin bus fighting the ogres with the light blue banner, no Urg, and considerably less goblins. So basically our generals killed each other. Urg ran the ogre through with his chop a sword, and the ogre basically fell on him and crushed him and crushed his pig, Sir Langston. And we all know what happens to an army of trolls and goblins without a leader. And the Iron Guts win their combat and implode. The bus I handed Gorked in, and trolls, I believe, panic and run off. And that's the game, boys. That's all she wrote. Here's the last shot of a squig running off into the distance, leaving behind a Doom Diver to be iron blastered. So, game two. Rough loss here. Rough loss. At this point, I knew my hopes of winning anything in this tournament were nil. And that was okay, frankly. I think I probably should not have sent Urg in. I could have detached him from the goblin unit somewhere around turn one, turn two. I would say turn two. And then maybe the bus could have fought alone. I had him attached mainly to avoid animosity. Animosity didn't hurt me this game, like it usually does for Orcs and Goblins. But what can you do? But yeah, this was game two of the 2015 Historicon ETC tournament, Warhammer 8th edition, as it was. And episode 7 of Where Night Goblins Dare. Thanks for listening.